Hello and welcome back. I want to give a special welcome to all of our Virtual Pass attendees. If you are watching on Virtual Pass, or if you're watching on YouTube, you can attend via Virtual Pass and watch the rest of the week's sessions at yaf.org/virtualpass. I have the distinct pleasure of introducing our next speaker. Ron Robinson has served as Young America's Foundation's president for more than four decades. Time magazine wrote that Young America's Foundation is now the nation's largest advocacy group devoted to student politics and referred to Robinson as one of the seasoned generals of the right who is leading the diverse and well-funded generation of conservatives who are winning battles on campus. Robinson has led the foundation through two successful landmark Supreme Court victories for students' rights, the inauguration and development of the National Conservative Student Conference and the National High School Leadership Conference, and the foundation's efforts to save Ronald Reagan's ranch, which you all will get the pleasure of seeing tomorrow. A native of Buffalo, New York, Robinson received a Bachelor of Arts degree in Political Science at Canisius College and a JD from the Catholic University of America. Please join me in welcoming Ron Robinson.
Thank you very much, Emily. I appreciate that. I appreciate all of you being here today and any watching online. One of the aspects of our program, I think, is anyone that comes to one of the foundation's core conferences, I don't want to leave without a pretty good grasp of what the conservative movement is. I wasn't with you last night at the Michael Reagan banquet. I'm sorry, I was elsewhere on foundation business, but I enjoy the part of this conference I enjoy the most is when you introduce yourselves and say why you're here. So I'm a little bit in the blind on what you said last night, but if it was similar to other high school programs we've had at the Reagan Ranch, you probably said you were here to either strengthen your conservative beliefs, learn more about the conservative movement, or otherwise reflect some general thought about the importance of the conservative movement. And so what is that movement's principles, what is that movement's strengths, what are the core beliefs of the conservative movement is where I eventually want our time together to head. But before I do that, I'd like to underscore why the conservative principles are so important. And that is, to me, of course, the reason we're involved in this, this was the reason Ronald Reagan was interested in passing his ideas on to young people. He said that in many, many speeches. Many of our founding fathers said similar things as well. Ben Franklin said the character of the nation is formed in its youth. President Lincoln is often quoted as saying the philosophy of the classroom today is the philosophy of government tomorrow. So there are many, many examples of American leaders through the years that have underscored the importance of getting the principles right. So there's an inherent case for the principles, but there's a secondary case for the principles, and that is that you will find that conservative personalities are vilified consistently, and you have a very recent case in that in Judge Kavanaugh, and liberal personalities are never exposed to the same type of coverage or the same type of reporting, and I want to underscore that. And I do that basically by taking the covers of Time, principally Time magazine. There's a few Newsweek stray covers still in here, but both Time and Newsweek were news weeklies that the editors, first the Time said directly to me, you can judge Time by its cover. It's not like a book. They recognize their covers and view their covers as iconic. They view themselves as being objective, those just presenting straightforward. And why this is important, why this represents the image that you have to deal with, is whether or not you've absorbed what I'm about to show you, your fellow classmates probably have. And when you look at news reports, you look at news weeklies, you look at other things that are covering personalities, what you will find is the mainline news media principally denigrates conservatives and presents liberals in the most favorable light. So when you try to advance conservative ideas and conservative principles, which is the ultimate goal the foundation would have, to understand and advance those, you have to understand that it's not always going to be helped by how the media portrays personalities. So let me give you some examples of this, starting with how liberals are traditionally portrayed. This is a cover, I think, of the last week or two of Time magazine, the persistence of Nancy Pelosi. I'm going to contrast this later. Let's say Nancy Pelosi's on the verge of becoming the House Speaker again. I'm going to show you a picture of Newt Gingrich when he was on the verge of becoming the House Speaker, as the media portrayed it earlier on. But this is pretty consistent, positive, flag in her lapel, red, white, and blue, portrayed very patriotic. If you go back to some of the presidential candidates, the Democratic ticket has always been portrayed in the most favorable light. This is a great example. John Kerry and John Edwards, the Sunshine Boys. No conservative has ever gotten a covered Time or Newsweek as positive as that one that the liberals get. Elizabeth Warren is who's afraid of Elizabeth Warren. Again, a nice smile, very positive presentation of her. Bernie could be your grandfather. Bernie socializing this America, beautiful smile, looking happy, very non-threatening. The fact that he wants to take your freedoms away wouldn't occur to you for a second. The next person probably is not portrayed as the most jolly and upbeat person, but sometimes the news media just has to make the best of what you have to work with. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, though, is an icon. And so when they portray liberal Supreme Court justices, they're generally very favorable. A good example is Justice Sotomayor, Latina justice, a positive portrayal of her on the cover. If you come forth with accusations against conservatives, this is, of course, Blasey Ford, The Lasting Impact. Probably the person who had to be the dumbest vice president that we've ever had, maybe Joe Biden, but I think Al Gore is right up there. But the liberal media consistently tries to paint Al Gore in the most favorable way. The thinking man's thinking man. So this is the smartest guy in the world, according to Newsweek in that particular time. If you are starting a new television show or recasting your career, they will put you forward as a very positive. She will shine at night, Katie's News. The Me Too movement is person of the year. Again, very positive covers. We're going to contrast this one when a conservative wins the person of the year. The Avengers, why the name sounds critical. This is a positive cover, obviously the smiles. These are the people who are going to avenge the males in society, I think. Ripped apart, this is when it wasn't law that President Trump put in position, it was just following the law. He took the oath of office to execute the laws of the United States, but when Time magazine wanted to portray what was going on at the border, it suggested that the president was going to rip apart families. Enough, this is from the shootings in the school in Florida. Again, not a surprising cover. This one might be a little bit more surprising to you. We are all socialists now. How could anyone disagree if you're a classmate? Everyone in the country is socialist now, right? That's certainly what it was portrayed. Well, how does this contrast with conservative movement leaders? I'm going to dip back a little bit further, but these are the examples of conservatives usually when they're on the cover are portrayed in the most negative ways. And I'm going to give you three examples for Ronald Reagan's communication director, and that is Pat Buchanan. You're going to hear from his sister tonight. Pat Buchanan was on the cover of Time magazine as Hellraiser. He was on the cover of Newsweek as Preaching Fear. And again, Newsweek came back as Bully Boy. So Hellraiser, Preaching Fear, Bully Boy. Who would like these characters? I showed you the Nancy Pelosi on the verge of becoming, assuming the Democrats win the House of Representatives next month. This is Newt Gingrich on the eve of his becoming Speaker of the House. Mad as hell, the GOP's Newt Gingrich. Actually, Newt was probably the happiest man in America at that particular time, but they portrayed him as almost a lunatic and being mad. When he became elected Speaker, they immediately went to work on him. This is, I think, my all-time favorite in terms of negative. Uncle Scrooge, he hadn't got to Christmas time. after that election, and he's portrayed as the person who's going to bash the poor at Christmas time. So no one watching any of the mainline news media is going to have a very positive opinion of Newt Gingrich if you absorb these things. Rush Limbaugh, very successful on radio. He was portrayed on the cover four times, always negatively. This is the earliest example. Voice of America, pairing him up with Howard Stern, screaming into the microphone, looking like a madman. This, again, would probably precondition anyone who hadn't listened to the Howard Stern show or the Rush Limbaugh show against him. I showed you the Sunshine Boys, the Democratic ticket. The Republican ticket were the Avengers. So at least they had a decent smile from the president, but not much better than that. Early in the last presidential cycle, I was a supporter of Ted Cruz. He showed up on the cover of Time magazine. I didn't even recognize him. I know Ted Cruz. Ted Cruz is a friend of mine. When the cover came out, I had to take a look and see that it was really Ted Cruz, but likable enough, certainly suggesting that no one would like him. Another person who's been a frequent speaker for the foundation, just actually a very good-looking woman, a parent, if you will, of 23, because she was a foster parent for a number of people, a congresswoman, ran for president herself. She's portrayed as the Queen of Rage, Michelle Bachmann of Minnesota. I'm not, Governor Christie is not my all-time favorite Republican politician, but I think that time was a little bit harsh when they portrayed him as the elephant in the room. I'm not the thinnest guy in America, but I don't think anyone, any politician wants to be portrayed as an elephant. Vice President Cheney was cleared, of course, and the left spent so much effort trying to besmirch his reputation. When it was clear that he was cleared, there still was a verdict, but they still suggested there was a cloud hanging over him. I told you probably Al Gore was maybe the dumbest vice president we had. Probably the lightest in the head vice president that we had would be Joe Biden, but he's portrayed as why Joe Biden is no joke. He actually was the biggest joke in Washington during his time period. I think he was chosen by Obama to make sure that no one would ever want to replace Obama with Joe Biden. President Obama, before he was a United States senator, when he was still a state senator, he received national publicity. And he was portrayed in the most favorable lights. And you could argue this is a person who eventually did become president. So maybe the magazines had proper foresight in that. But of course, they were part of the drivers of that. And I'm going to go through a number of his as he emerged and then as president of the United States. This is the first example in 2005. So he was not yet elected to the United States Senate. That happened in 2006. Seeing purple with a great, wonderful smile. What does purple mean in this case? Anyone? Yes. Yes, the red and the blue, he would unite those. So that was portraying him from the very first time he appeared on a national stage as he was the individual who was going to unite the country. He had many, many positives. This is a good example. He could be the next president, but if you just saw that in a newsstand, you would see he was going to be the next president. How much does experience matter? He'd only been senator for 2 years. That was a criticism. Time comes to his defense by saying, does experience really matter? I wonder if they would say that now that we have a president that didn't have any prior government experience. I don't think you'd see that cover for Donald Trump. When he got elected president, rightly so, he deserved a favorable and positive cover. Most presidents of the United States got that when they were elected. So he was 44th president, you would expect that. It says at the top, President Obama. But along the way, you had, even if you criticize him, why are Obama's critics so dumb? If you were a critic of any way of Barack Obama or his presidency, you were the one that had the problem, not him. Let me shift to Hillary Clinton, because that's a little bit more current for you than President Obama being elected 10 years ago. Hillary was first portrayed after being First Lady as her turn to become a United States Senator from New York. Well, I'm a native New Yorker. And the idea that it was her turn to become the senator from New York, a state that she had never lived in, just because she had been the first lady, is presumptuous to say the least. But that's what the liberals presumed. She's been portrayed many, many times on the cover favorably. This is Newsweek, Women of the Year. What Hillary believes, when people were questioning whether she had any belief other than she wanted power. I found my voice when people criticized her as not really knowing what she believed in other than wanting to be president of the United States. Hear her roar, again, that's not in a negative, that's a positive, again, trying to say she was assertive enough to be president of the United States. The fighter, again, with a very, very happy smile. You're going to see President Trump here in a little bit and how he's portrayed, but I guarantee you, you're not going to see anything quite like that one. Smart power. How could you not elect a person president of the United States if they had smart power? And she was the first in many things, implying, of course, that she would be the first female president of the United States. Contrast that with Donald Trump. Donald Trump first appeared on the cover of Newsweek giving the finger, at first as a political candidate, giving a finger to the American people. The art of the bad deal. Time magazine portrayed him as bully, showman, party crasher, demagogue, who would want to make him the 45th president of the United States. Keep those references in mind. Bully, showman, party crasher, demagogue. You didn't hear any of that for any Democratic or liberal candidate or person, and you never will from the mainline news media. He was elected president of the United States. Deal with it. That's the most favorable cover he received, person of the year. I don't know why they have him seated away looking backwards. I don't even know why he agreed to that picture. You'd have to make your own interpretation whether that was portrayed as a positive one. It certainly was the most positive picture Donald Trump received as president. This one, the summit crisis, they merge Putin's head into Trump's head, or a combination. I hope you picked that up. It takes a little bit of looking at it. Incoming, what does incoming mean? Anyone from a military family? What does incoming usually mean? Yes? No? No? Yep. Right, usually means artillery fires coming in, incoming, sometimes it could be aerial, but more often than not, you're being shelled. Someone's attacking you, shelling you. This is what he meant to Washington. Again, portraying he's going to break Washington. Actually, it was a disruptor of Washington, so you could potentially make a case of this. But again, it's all portraying a very negative impression of him. Nothing to see here. This was early in his presidency, suggesting that he wasn't really interested in what was going on in terms of running the government. That changed quickly in the liberals' point of view. But again, it shows you the negativity towards him right from the get-go. Stormy later, so they took, these are separate covers. These are not merged covers. Again, this is what your classmates are seeing when they go to see in newsstands or elsewhere. Time comes to their home. In deep, suggesting he was in over his head in water with issues as being president of the United States. The riskiest show on earth, again, suggesting working with the North Korean dictator is a risky proposition. You can make your own judgment of that. But if a liberal was working with them, I doubt if we'd call it risky. This is probably his second most favorable one. Why he always bounces back. So I think time was a little bit beside themselves that his policies and were as successful as they have been, and that he had succeeded in doing a number of things. So 45th president, a little bit surprised there. This is the way time traditionally dealt with him. First, when he was a candidate, meltdown, suggesting certainly that his campaign was collapsing, that he was not going to be elected president of the United States. The next one was total meltdown, in case anyone missed the message and the prior one. They couldn't leave it at that. But then they had to come and deal with it again, year one. So, you know, they just, it was relentless attack on the president. Time, the wrecking crew, this is Trump destroying things around him. Trump, king me, being treated like he should be royalty. This was a doctored picture. You probably remember there was some controversy about this. It was a picture that there's only, I think, been three times when Time or Time magazine doctored a picture. Once when they darkened the skin of O.J. Simpson. Once when they airbrushed smoke in on a picture of Rush Limbaugh with a big cigar, but they airbrushed smoked in. And this was the third doctored picture in recent years of Time magazine. The Swamp Hotel, he's got a wonderful hotel in Washington. They're implying that's where the most corruption is. Again, an attack on the Russian front, suggesting the White House is the Kremlin. Some of his top aides, they also didn't escape the liberal leftist treatment. Steve Bannon, his general campaign chairman, is called the great manipulator when he was at the White House, a very negative picture of Steve Bannon. Have you seen the film on the Reagan Ranch so far? He's the producer of that film. I don't know if that was pointed out to you. I probably noticed that at the beginning. The president's son, caught red-handed because he took a meeting with a Soviet or a Russian person. General Kelly, early in his time as White House Chief of Staff, is Trump's last best hope. So it was in the earliest days of the administration, but they're already basically portraying as the administration is basically done. This is his last chance. Fellow YAF leader, Attorney General Sessions, who there's some controversy about him, of course, but they're trying to portray him against the president. Nobody's above the law. Suggesting that Sessions was saying the president thinks he's above the law. I think you get the message I'm trying to say. If you're promoting liberal ideas and you have to do the caricatures to the extent that's been done by the mainline news media, that's not confidence in your underlying positions. That's not confidence in what you do to achieve good government. That's trying to stack the deck so that everyone dislikes conservative personalities and likes liberal personalities. So conservative personalities come out as the great manipulator. Deal with it when you become president of the United States. Mad as hell when you become Speaker of the House. Compared to the persistence, our time for change has come, and smart power, just as a summary of the left. So this is why I stress to you the importance of understanding conservative principles. Because the discussions that you want to have, go back to the recent debate on the U.S. Supreme Court. The discussions fundamentally, why are people opposing Judge Kavanaugh? Why was that handled in the way that it was? Probably because Judge Kavanaugh believed in limited government, believed that the United States Constitution was designed to restrain the growth of government and the power of government so you as individual citizens could make more choices in your own life. This is diametrically opposed to the liberal point of view, which wants an omnipotent government deciding everything for you. Liberals want to live your life. They want to make decisions for you. They want to decide how your money's going to be spent. They want to decide what kind of light bulbs we have. They're going to try to decide how much water we have in the tanks and the toilets in the back. They're going to try to decide how much you put away for retirement. So liberals want to run your life. Conservatives want you to run your own life. And that's the fundamental difference on the Supreme Court today. Do we have a Supreme Court that recognizes the Constitution as a limitation of government power? Or do we have a Supreme Court to lead in the advance of government taking over your lives? And the real reason they besmirch someone like Judge Kavanaugh, as compared to so many of the Democratic leaders, former President Clinton himself was going back on the road for Democratic candidates, is not because of his treatment of women, whether you believe any factual basis in what Ford had to say or not, but because of what Kavanaugh presumably believes on the principles of the Constitution of the United States. So let us turn to the principles of the conservative movement and try to cover some of the items I believe that you've already done and each of your respective groups. So let's begin with Group A. Do you have a spokesman for Group A?
Yes, sir.
Why don't you step up? I think this is on, but they'll turn it on, I think.
All right, here.
Maybe.
Test 1, 2. Here Jack. We go. All right. Yes, sir.
Tell us what you think are the most prominent conservative principles your group brought out.
So our group talked a lot. We had some really good discussions, but really we said, okay, well, what about conservative? What do we care most about? We care most about traditional values in the Constitution. And from there, we kind of came up with these three, which is we care a lot about the First Amendment.
What is it about the First Amendment you care about?
Specifically, freedom of speech. Mm-hmm. We think that's a really, really, really big deal.
But you know, also, what else is in the First Amendment?
Freedom of religion, press, and assembly, right?
Right, right. And we should go ahead.
The right to petition the government.
Right to petition the government, which I think is important. Sometimes they're trying to restrict lobbyists, for example. You can criticize lobbies and what they do, but it's a right to lobby government to try to change policy or to try to protect yourself from policy. They also left out the Establishment Clause of the First Amendment. Does anyone know what the Establishment Clause basically requires? Yes.
Is that the one that's about making or enforce for the bill?
It's the Congress shall make no laws limiting the free exercise or create a national established religion. To establish a religion. What did the Founding Fathers mean, just to get this clear on the First Amendment, what did the Founding Fathers mean by an established religion, you know?
Create something like other countries have, like, that are basically totally non-secular states, I guess.
Non-secular states? Go ahead.
No organized institution, i.e. the monarchy at that point, would be allowed to dictate what the people's rights were because the rights of the people came solely from them.
May flow from it. Anyone else? Yes.
They didn't want any replication of the Church of England.
What about the Church of England? Did they have one replicated?
The Church of England, they, because of how powerful the line the church was with the government, that what was the rules and establishments of the church ended up becoming the rules and establishments of the government. An extension is the church pretty much became an extension of the government.
That's very close. I don't want to get too far astray, but I want you to know if you choose the First Amendment, the liberals are going to talk about the Establishment Clause, not the Free Exercise Clause. I want to come back to the Free Exercise Clause because conservatives generally understand that and are very sympathetic to that. Conservatives tend to think that the No Establishment Clause hurts our case or is wrong or is been taken over by the liberals, which it largely has been. The No Establishment Clause, 9 of the original 13 colonies had established religions. And by established religions, we meant something that was so important to the Founding Fathers. The citizens of those states were taxed to support a particular church. So keep in mind, the Founding Fathers didn't like the tax, and they didn't like, if they were in a minority in any of those states, they didn't like having to support another church. And what the Establishment Clause said is the federal government will not have an established religion. There will not be one church for the United States that people have to pay taxes for and support. And eventually, the 13 states all eventually stripped away so that you went from 9 eventually to no states with established religions. But you had established religions even after the First Amendment was passed, but you didn't have a nationally established religion. But the Free Exercise Clause, which you cited, let's come back to that. Why is that so important to you?
It just feeds into the freedom that we have, which actually feeds into, we also, we're big about respect, dignity of human life. We think that you have the freedom to believe how you want, have hold convictions to that and be able to live that out freely without the government interfering.
Good. In free exercise, free speech, how does free speech stand up in high school?
you should be able to think and say what you want.
Yeah, I agree with that. Yeah. I agree with that. In fact, the founding, the Supreme Court has said that you don't lose your First Amendment rights at the schoolhouse door in the Tinker decision. Those of you that are in public school should remember that. There are some time and place limitations, but you did not give up your First Amendment rights when you go to public school. Anything else that you want to bring up?
Our third thing that we said was patriotism is what we believe in. That
why should we be patriotic?
Because it sustains our republic, our democracy.
Have you been good to your family?
Yes, sir.
Probably part of the reason. What was the second? Remind me the second again.
The dignity of life, human rights. Right.
I think, and I'm glad it was brought out in the first board. Appreciate you doing that. I think that one of the aspects of the conservative movement you should be most proud of is that we've been protecting and working for the protection of the most vulnerable people in our society, the unborn. We have lost more than 50 million since Roe v. Wade, a decision that everyone who has any sense of science and medicine today knows is an outdated decision. That decision said that the life was not sustainable in the second trimester. That just is medically and scientifically wrong. You probably know young men and young women who were born in that second trimester, whether you know it or not. So when the left sometimes says conservatives aren't into science, just cite them the Roe v. Wade and talk about the science that they purportedly believe is so sacrosanct as they do in that particular decision. Jack, I appreciate it. Appreciate your contribution. Glad to have you with us.
Who's Group B? Group B the best? What is this all about? A little braggadocio, is this better? Is it mine on? This one's working? Or should we both use it? I'm missing what you're saying. To give for him?
Yeah.
Skip the other one.
No, you use that.
Oh, the other one. Use the other one. All right, I'm with you. Okay. How you doing?
Good
to have you. You've been here before, though.
I have, a couple times.
And you should know all the conservative movies.
I should.
Do the people know who you are?
In my group?
Or in the whole school. Do they know that your background?
I think we talked about it the first night.
Okay, I missed the first night, so I'm sorry.
It was pretty fun.
I don't want to put you on
it
the spot,
fun.
But I mean, this should be easy for you.
I don't know.
So what do you want to highlight?
I think, so we didn't really select any specifically, but I would say God-given rights.
Okay.
As the first point. Just
what
because
does that mean? What is God-given rights versus rights given?
Because, what the government can give you, they can take away. So, I mean, if the government has control over what rights they can take away. Also, I think it feeds into, like, Judeo-Christian values, being grounded in morals and values before what the government tells you. So, our other point was, capitalism. So capitalism and free market and upward mobility, also kind of feeds into personal responsibility. You're responsible for yourself, the government is responsible for you, and you're making the right decisions for you and your family, which ultimately helps society as a whole. And then I'm trying to think of the last point.
Those are pretty good. I want to put you on the spot.
Okay.
Forgive me for doing this, if you're uncomfortable doing
this.
But you shared that your parents are TV stars. Did you share that?
My parents went on MTV.
Right.
Right.
They were TV stars for an earlier generation, maybe not my generation, but a subsequent generation.
Okay.
And your dad's a congressman.
He is.
Both of her in the limelight. Your mother does almost every major national television show. How's your family? Is the left been courteous to your family? Is it?
No. My mom came out against Jay-Z in a segment on TV. And it got pretty intense. So no, the left is not very tolerant of other ideas or other perspectives. So,
and I bring that out because I think that's an important issue today. One of the differences between the left and conservatives today is the left are treating people that they disagree with in the most intolerant way. And I didn't know the answer when I asked you that question, but I was going to assume that given the courageous way in which your parents have stood up on public issues, that they would be under attack. I hate that that's the case, but I assume that that's the case, and that's why I asked you to share that. It is a big difference today between the left and the right.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else you want to share?
No, I'd say that kind of covers it.
Give your parents my regard, Jack.
Will
Thank
do.
You. Appreciate you being with us. Appreciate all you do. Who's Group C? And I didn't pick Jack to come up here. I don't know who did in your group, but I'm glad you came up. You shared a little bit more than what otherwise would have been the case. How are you?
I'm good.
Good, Gideon, good to have you with us. Why don't you bring out a couple things that haven't been brought out so far that your group zeroed in on?
All right, is this on? This is working out. So we already went over God-given rights, but we have not gone over individual...
Wait, let me stick with God-given rights.
Oh, you want to go over that again? Okay.
What does American exceptionalism
mean? American exceptionalism. Well, it's the Constitution was based on Judeo-Christian values, and the American exceptionalism is basically saying, American, why is American exceptional?
So why is American exceptional?
Because of our morals and our...
If you and Jack hit something that's tied directly to that. A lot of times when people talk about American exceptionalism, because you raised this as one of the first topics and Jack did as well, but this point needs to be made, oftentimes lost. When there's reference to American exceptionalism, a lot of people think that Americans are just bragging. We're a great country. President Obama thought that's what the meaning of it was. He said, yes, America is exceptional, but British think British is exceptional, and Greeks think Greece is exceptional. And maybe they are in their own way. But what the founding fathers meant by American exceptionalism is tied to what both of you began with, which is God-given rights. Government, we were the first government endowed with the idea that rights came from God. And government was endowed to protect those rights. So when you talk about, as it was discussed, the First Amendment and individual liberties, Second Amendment. These were rights that Americans' founders believed that they received from God, not from government. And government was there to protect those rights. So what you start out by saying God-given rights, that's American exceptionalism. That's what is meant by that term. President Obama didn't understand that. As high school students, you're already ahead of him. But it's absolutely right. It was a fundamental point to the founding fathers. We have these rights, we're gonna protect them. King George can't take them from us, King George can't give them to us. And that's what we mean by God-given rights. But share another one too, and I will try not to go off.
All right, so for next one, we're gonna go with an individualism / traditionalism. I mean, three was just too little, so we decided to kind of combine them. Individualism is basically, the right, or the conservatives, tend to treat people as individuals instead of the left, who usually treat people as groups. Like they kind of put people aside by groups. Like if you're in the 1%, you're in a group. Everybody in the 1% is like this. Everybody that's black or African Americans need to vote Democrat, because they're the party of the Democrats. Individualism is traditionally it's conservative, because, well, we believe that people have their rights are as individuals over their rights as a group.
Excellent. I agree with that. Core conservative principle. Give us one more, and then we'll let it go.
All right. Morality, external versus internal. So absolute truth versus relative truth. Conservatives tend to believe in absolute truth instead of, like, the liberals going, this is my truth, my beliefs. This is what, they can change. An absolute truth, which is what a conservative believes, is a truth that cannot be changed. Like, it's a God-given right, it's an absolute truth that we have the right to freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, and those things. That's morally, that's what conservatives believe.
So it's not moral relativism. The example, the easiest example, when people say there's no truth, everyone's truth is subjective. Well, if you go up on top of the roof here at this building and jump off, I guarantee you that the 100% of the time, the law of gravity is going to work. You're going to fall four floors, and it's not relative. It's not going to be true for some people and not for others. And conservatives believe there's certain eternal truths in society like that. I'll give you a truth that you should probably, or law of nature, that's tied to a truth,
that sometimes conceptually is hard to believe, but if you look through all human history, this is basically true, and you're on the verge of it if you're not there already. Through all human history, as far as we know, and in all societies, when you get to the ages 17, 18, 19, there's a tendency to seek to be a little bit more free from your parents, to establish yourself a little bit differently, have different ideas than they have already. That's a law of nature. You know, you could say, oh, I know one person somewhere that is a contradiction to that. But why is that true through different generations? So it's one of the truths that there might be some individual exceptions to, but it still doesn't negate the overall moral or natural law concept that basically has been true through different generations, your parents' generations, your grandparents' generations. It'll be true with your children's generations. It's just a general truism. So I appreciate it. Gideon, thank you for your presentation. All right, group D is 1,024th percent cool. Who's that? Or not percent, percent. Who's representing that group? Who came up with that idea? Good. And your name?
My name is Haley Pitschke.
Haley, great to have you with us. Okay. So why don't you hit some of the items in your group that haven't been brought out already?
Okay, so I think
I don't know if people can see the board, but you can.
So. I can see the board. Okay, so individual responsibility was a really big one that we talked about a lot in our group. So individual responsibility is a conservative value, and a lot of more liberal values, they value collectivism, and collectivism to us is dangerous overall.
So what's the difference between individual rights and individual responsibilities?
Individual rights are the rights that you have that are given to you by God, and everyone has them. Individual responsibility are the things that you have to do in order to succeed in life and in order to ensure your future. So
give me an example of an individual responsibility.
Okay, so for example, I know that no one else in this room is responsible for my grades, right? It's my responsibility to make sure that I get good grades. It is only my responsibility to make sure that I get good grades, and it is only my responsibility to make sure that I go to college and to make sure that I secure my future job or to make sure that I function in the future overall.
Great example. Great example. Primary responsibility. Walter Williams says the best social program is begin by taking care of your own life, and then you can build out from there. You may have an individual responsibility to take care of a family if you're a parent. Maybe that becomes a parental responsibility, but I think you've nailed it perfectly, and conservatives tend to give greater respect to that responsibility, try to fulfill it more often, generally, you would say. I'm asking, but you would think so, right?
Yes, of course.
What else would you like to stress?
Constitutionalism. And rule by the people. So we think that that's very, very important, and that is one of the primary tenets of conservatism. The Constitution, like you said, American exceptionalism is very important because our God-given rights are, you know, secured by God and only God. But the constitutional, that gives the government rights. So the Constitution is not giving rights to the people, and we think that's very, very, very important to stress. Because in society and other countries, they don't have the freedoms that we have because they don't have the Constitution that we have.
So what would you say if a liberal said to you, conservatives believe in the Constitution, you know, but the Constitution was 200 years old or plus, and it was put together by slaveholders. What would you say to that?
I would say, first of all, we should argue ideas, not people, so we shouldn't argue about who the individuals who created the document were, but rather argue the flaws in the document. The founders made sure that it was amendable, so if there are any huge issues, like, for example, slavery, we can go back and amend them and fix them. I would also say that the Constitution is securing our rights, like protecting us from the government. So it's making sure that the government can't infringe on the rights that are given to us by God. So it's very important to us to protect us from what could potentially become a totalitarian government like every other government in the history of ever.
But a government like that might work in small rural America with 3 million people. Does it really work in a society of 350 million people?
I mean, we had like Russia, and that was really bad. So I heard this quote, and it was, if you want to make a Democrat believe in the Constitution, have them go and read about communist Russia. So if we want to take a look at things that have happened in other large in large countries and in countries that are also modernized, we can see that they don't have the same rights as us. So for example, like we can look at the Tommy Robinson case, and that's a like prime example of how they just don't have freedom of speech.
In Britain.
In Britain.
Not my son, Tom Robinson. Some building, right?
No.
Different Tom Robinson.
Different Tommy Robinson. Yeah. So it's... sorry, I don't mean to laugh at you.
It's all right.
So it's very important to us that we are protected from a government that could, of course, potentially decide just, oh, you guys no longer have rights. I mean, without the Constitution, they could just decide that.
I think that's an excellent answer, and I'd be totally comfortable with that answer. I'm going to give at least one other suggestion to our audience in how to answer it, but yours is fine. You know, that argument sometimes given that it was passed for a society of 3 million people. My answer to that is those 3 million people had government close to them. They had just taken over the government. That 3 million people included great people, I think four people with great foresight, like Washington, Jefferson, Madison, Franklin, many brilliant people we would consider brilliant to this day, is the Trumps and the Obamas in better position to make decisions for your lives in a society of 350 million Americans better than George Washington and Thomas Jefferson was for a society of 3 million? The Federalist Papers, especially in Federalist Paper number 10, Madison argued that when society becomes bigger, our Constitution becomes even a greater protection because it protects you against various factions. So the Founding Fathers believed that as the society became larger, the Constitution was even more important. But that's another argument to liberals don't, they somehow look at it like it's a quantitative decision, not what really was happening with government. Give us one more out of your group. Who said you were only this cool, by the way? You're doing a great job on these answers.
I don't know. This is just luck. Okay. So we talked.
We don't want to equate you with Elizabeth Warren in any way.
Oh, no. Well, we're just saying, like, we're just that cool. You know, we're super cool because that means like, you're totally that, you know?
Okay. All right. Totally cool. Yeah. All right. I didn't get that.
Oh, yeah.
I'm with you now.
We talked about a strong national defense and, like, a police force.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. I don't know.
So why, if you're for a limited government, why would you want a strong national defense?
Okay, so the government only really has one big job in the general gist of it, right? It's to protect and secure the rights of the people. And in order to do that, they need to have a strong national defense to do things like, you know, stop the spread of communism or, like, make sure that North Korea doesn't nuke us. Right. Like, all these things that are very important because if, like, North Korea decided to nuke us, like, that would be problematic, you know? That would pose other countries can pose a threat to our national security and therefore to our rights. So therefore, we need to have a strong national defense and a strong national police force to make sure that other people don't infringe on our rights within the country and to make sure that people from that outside forces in other countries don't infringe on the rights of us. Yeah.
So what would be the strong national police force?
So the strong national police force would be local, like, police forces that we have.
So it wouldn't be national, it would be local.
Yes, yeah, but okay. It's like...
Just clarify that.
On a national scale.
Does anyone really support a strong national police?
No.
Yeah, that's probably a little bit change in terms there.
It's a little
that we leave to local government to make that decision, but they would need to be strong enough to protect the life and property of American citizens. Mm-hmm. We have enemies, foreign and domestic, but for the domestic protection, we largely rely on local government. Very good. I appreciate the job you did. Thank you very much. Our final group, Group E. Who's the spokesperson for Group E?
That's me.
How are you?
I'm good.
Your name?
I'm Mallory Tranmer.
Great to have you with us.
Awesome.
So,
good to be here.
Why don't you bring out what you want to bring out that hasn't been brought out already?
So one thing that I really want to touch on is defending the Bill of Rights as it was written. In our group, we discussed
What's the Bill of Rights?
The Bill of Rights is the first 10 amendments of the Constitution.
Okay.
So what we wanted to point out was that while each side can argue that they're defending the Bill of Rights, what we're doing is we're defending as it's written. As especially with freedom of speech, when the liberals talk, they're saying, oh yeah, I have the freedom of speech to do this. But then as we say something that, like, as we have a rebuttal, they're like, what do you mean? That's wrong. You're stupid. Like, no, that's not how it works. You know, that's kind of how we talked. But then when we talk, we always look at both sides of the story. We look at both pros and cons. Okay. Of each story. Sorry, I can't breathe. I'm talking too fast.
It's all right. Talking about the Bill of Rights and why you think the Bill of Rights was important.
Yeah. And so that's why we did that. That's why we chose that one. Another one that I want to touch on is Constitution is the foundation of our values, because we touched on that one because a lot of times people think that, or the left or liberals think that our constitutional values change with public opinion, but they don't. The Constitution doesn't change. I mean, it's amendable and we can change it, but for the fact that it's changeable with public opinion, that isn't necessarily true. So that's what another thing we touched on. And the last thing we touched on was our free market. And I use the example of what I'm learning in economy, in economics right now, not economy, but that in a controlled economy, we're not able to trade with other people, right? But in a free market like ours, we're able to trade with whoever we want. And then we put that in the political perspective that we can talk to whoever, like we can have our own beliefs so we can learn what we want. And that's a lot of what we're about. We're not limited, and we allow people to have other opinions where the left are more closed-minded about that.
Good, good. I appreciate your contribution. Thank you very much. Good.
Thank you.
Let me take a second to build on that last answer, because I think that one of the differences between, and I didn't miss any groups, did I? One of the differences between the left and right today is conservatives more so believe that Ronald Reagan had a thing about lower taxes. You all know that Ronald Reagan was for lower taxes. Tomorrow you'll see the tax table where he signed the biggest tax cut in American history. Ronald Reagan had a way of expressing himself to cast a very wide net that's worth you considering and answering why you would be for lower taxes. Ronald Reagan said the person who earns the income should have the biggest say over how that income is going to be spent. So if you earn the income, you should have the biggest say over how it's going to be spent. Most Americans would agree with that. And then he would say, you will make a better decision, or the person who earned the income will make a better decision on how it's going to be spent than a bureaucrat in Washington or Sacramento. And most of you probably would agree with that. And then you say, therefore, I'm for lower taxes. But one of the big differences in the country today between conservatives and liberals or socialists or progressives, whatever term you want to use on the other side, is conservatives don't feel threatened by inequality in income. If Bill Gates earns $1 billion, I don't begrudge Bill Gates the $1 billion. Liberalism today, they like to think they have a virtue in criticizing conservatives as being greedy. But the flip side is liberalism today is largely based on a vice, and that vice is envy. That vice is coveting thy neighbor's goods. That's the essence of liberalism today. It's basically begrudging other people the success that they might have. Now, we have an obligation, as I think, if you believe in the Judeo-Christian heritage, of helping other people. But we don't fulfill that obligation by taxing somebody else. We fulfill that obligation by doing something about it ourselves. But I want to give you two arguments to wrap up that you might be able to think about and use in trying to convince your classmates that conservatives, at least on these economic issues, are more on track than liberals are, at least in their own lives. And let's begin with grades. You probably have heard this analogy before, but your teachers may be very socialist. They may not be, but if they are, they probably still have a grade system. And some get A, some get B, some get C, D, and F. Well, what about going to your teacher and say, this person doesn't need an A to get into college. They're going to do all right. But having an F on their report card, that's going to be social injustice. So why don't we no longer have any A's and no longer have any F's, and we have the B's, C's, and D's?
And then let's say you're even a Bernie Sanders socialist and you think everybody should just get C. What do you think would happen to the scholarship in your class? Would you cram for exams? You're putting thumbs down. It would go down, right? Why would it go down?
Why would it go down?
Yeah.
Why put in work if everybody's going to get the same grade?
Right. Why put in work if everyone's going to get the same grade? So how many of you people have crammed before a final exam? Yeah. Well, if the exam didn't make any difference, why would you cram, right? I mean, I've gone through graduate school and law school. I learned that lesson a long time ago. If there's no grade, you're going to probably put in less effort than you would otherwise. Your teachers know that. You should know that. That is basically understanding that inequality in the classroom in your lives already does not lead to injustice. It leads actually to probably encouraging people to improve their effort and improve their livelihood. I'll give you one other example that you can use, I think, with your peers, and that is in music. You could argue that in a democratic society or a democratic socialist society, government, as long as they have a majority of people behind them, if they have a majority of people behind them, they should be able to decide anything. It's a democracy. So why don't we let government decide things? How many of you would want to go to Senator Brown or Senator Feinstein to decide what music you want to listen to? How many would you like to go to your local congressmen or senators to decide what bands ought to play in society today? You wouldn't want government deciding the music for you. How many here have between 100 and 500 tunes in their music collection? By show of hands, between 100 and 500. How many have between 500 and 1,000? How many have over 1,000? Do the rest of you that answered in the first group feel threatened by the last group? Do you want to take the rights away because there's inequality? Think about your classmates. The answer obviously is no. You don't want government telling you what music to listen to. If government decided which bands were going to be successful, you'd all still be listening to the Glenn Miller Orchestra or something that your grandparents listened to, because they would be saying we have to save those jobs. The marketplace decides that, and the marketplace has inequality. But it leads to a better result where each individual person can make those decisions for themselves. So those are two arguments you can use with your fellow classmates for the idea of freedom and not turning it over government, because there is inequality. You could argue that there's only a small number of groups that control the concerts. You can argue that there's only a small number of labels, and that's unfair in the music industry. But I don't think anyone that's young and has different tastes in music wants a government bureau to decide what you listen to. So think about the things in your lives and whether you would want government deciding those issues for them yourself, or whether you would make better decisions on your own. I thought you as a group did a wonderful job. I hope that these are principles that you can fight for in your life. The idea of individual freedom. Individual responsibility. People oftentimes don't talk about fighting for it, but you're going to lead a much better life if you lead a life of individual responsibility. The idea of right to life, protecting life when you can. You know, the left talks about protecting the environment. They talk about, to a greater extent probably than conservatives, about protecting different animals. But the animals they want to protect, they protect the full life cycle. The American bald eagle, they didn't just protect people from killing the bald eagle, they protected the nesting and they protected the eggs of the bald eagle. Why would we do anything less for the human species? We know scientifically today that it's a different life. It's not the same life as the mother or the same life as the father. And so one of the great attributes of the modern day conservative cause is it's a championship, it's a champion for life. You should be proud of that. When we've had presidents like Reagan, and I think like President Trump, our society has been better off. Today we have lower unemployment across the board. We have lower unemployment for every minority group. More Americans are making more decisions in their own lives and less by government than before. That was especially true in the Reagan years. They said he would be a hawk. They said his peace through strength policy would lead to war. It led to peace. It led to the end of the Cold War and liberation of 500 million people behind the Iron Curtain. This is a movement and the principles of the movement that you should be proud of. The reason the left does caricatures of calling conservatives bully boys and preaching figure and hell raising and that type of thing, and they're only the sunshine boys, they're the smart power, is because they don't want to defend their ideas. They want to paint a picture and make that decision for everyone else. Don't let them make that decision for you. Don't let them make that decision for your classmates. Stand up for your conservative beliefs, and you'll be stronger in life. Thank you very much for being with us today.